Just the phrase defund the police. Were you surprised that it's become as prominent a national conversation as it has?
In this amount of time frame, I first started thinking about and sort of really sitting with the concept of what defunding looks like maybe 5 years ago. In the early days with BYP 100, the New York City chapter, and the Movement for Black Lives, coming out of Ferguson and Mike Brown, and there have been people from decades previous who have been, sitting with similar questions. You know, organizations like Critical Resistance, folks such as Miriam Kaba, Angela Davis, Ruth Wilson Gilmore. And so, this is a part of a broader legacy, but in recent years, I've really been thinking a lot about it and incorporating it into the framework of my broader research and also, the work that I do. And so, I've been thinking about this for a long time, and I've been discussing it with people, but it's sort of been niche for years. And then within the span of 2 weeks, it went from something I was talking about in a niche way to being a trending topic that pretty much, I don't know if anybody has not heard of it. And just to clarify some of the confusion, I think when people hear defunding, they just think moving something. But the broader framework, what it's actually called, is invest, divest. And so the framework is that divesting from policing, as well as other systems of punishment like jails and prisons, and reinvesting those funds into community resources and institutions, which we know the safest communities don't have the most police, they have the most resources. But also alternatives to emergency response, that don't center around policing, because this system of policing, it's not creating the safety that it's allegedly supposed to do, and it's disproportionately that's true for Black people and other marginalized communities of color, but it's true for the entire nation, because in many ways, in different instances, for safety and for interventions, the options are calling the police and leading to prison and arrest and punishment, or doing nothing. And so many people are forced to oftentimes do nothing for all kinds of forms of harm and conflict, including different forms of patriarchal violence, because the options, and that's why we know there's so much forms of harm and conflict and violence that are underreported, because the options are set up in a way that it doesn't lead to the sorts of accountability and safety and transformative justice and giving people what they need in order to be, repaired and restored and healed from harm, and also the opportunity for people who engage in harm to be transformed through that process. Because we sort of operated for decades on this model of punishment and vengeance, which is why the United States incarcerates the most people in the entire world, and the people on the front lines of that are police, right? We know if people end up in prison, someone has to be putting them there.